Nürburgring is the most famous track in Germany. I mean, it's by far the oldest, with a lot of histories, good races here. I mean, not only the Formula One, a lot of good history in sports car racing in the mid-80s, 70s, going to the 90s, and for sure the Nordschleife is a big part as well of the legacy of the Nürburgring. But yeah, in the people's head, if you ask the German people about the racing track, I mean, the first answer would be the Nürburgring. The German racing fans are, yeah, very well known into motorsport. They're really enthusiastic and they're also, I would say, quite detailed. They've been here the last time in 91, 92, where the last sports car race, world sports car race was held, and you could see that they just were waiting for this day to come back. If you see before a race that the grandstands are full, it gives you some extra boost, some extra pump for the driver and some extra pressure for sure to perform well in front of a big crowd. To give the emotion to the people is a big pleasure of our sport. It's legacy, it's speed, and it's a heart of German racing.
Previously on WEC.
Before we enter into the fourth round of the World Endurance Championship, let's take a look back to our previous rounds, Silverstone, Spa and Le Mans. Toyota, with an all-new TSO50, showed they had the pace in Spa, putting in a strong fight against Audi and Porsche. It was tragedy at Le Mans after a consistent performance for 23 hours and 55 minutes. They crawled to a halt.
In Silverstone, we are a little bit down on the pace, but since Spa, we have been very competitive, and I'm sure that we can keep that shape and hopefully even better than in Spa and Le Mans. So I just want to win a few races and then think about the championship later on.
Audi number 7 was competitive in Spa but had that win revoked, and the number 8 claimed their first WEC win in Spa. At Le Mans, they were plagued with issues, but the number 8 still made it to the podium.
We are second in the championship, but the gap to Porsche is big. We have to perform, we have to win races if we want to fight for the title. We won already a race, we finished on podium in Le Mans. So now just try to keep the momentum and everything can happen.
The Porsche number 1 had a dramatic start to the season, with the number 2 being handed the victory at Silverstone. That drama continued in Spa. And it was turned around with that unbelievable win at Le Mans. Porsche takes the lead of the championship, but as you can see, the competitors are not far behind.
You have to have everyone on the paper, because they have been strong in various tracks, and now with the high downforce, it's really a big question mark before this race, and probably we know a lot more after this race. But yeah, it's exciting because everyone can win the race.
In LMP2, Signatec Alpine were always expected to be strong contenders, and they have not let us down. A great win in Le Mans for Lapierre, Riquelme and Menezes. In GTM, it's the number 83 Ferrari leading the championship, continuing their top-class performance from last season.
Unbelievable. I love you guys. You're the best. We made history here.
In GT Pro, it's been an incredible return for Ford, repeating history and battling against old rivals Ferrari.
Le Mans, the car was really good. In Silverstone and Spa, we struggled a little bit. So let's see how we are in these kind of configurations. Nürburgring is a high downforce circuit, and we have to see. We don't know really. I'm quite sure we will be strong.
After winning in 2015, Porsche have had a slow start to the season and will be looking to fight back. Ferrari are close contenders and second in the championship with 103 points. However, it's Aston Martin Racing leading the manufacturer GT Cup with 112 points. It's time to get back to the championship. We still have 6 races remaining. That's 36 hours of nail-biting racing. And with such strong performances from all of the teams, nothing is finalised.
A brilliant start to the 2016 FIA World Endurance Championship season, and no reason to think there'll be anything less than excitement and entertainment at round 4 here at the Nürburgring in the Eifel Mountains of Germany, where the German enthusiasts have turned out in force to support their favourites. There's plenty of local interest too, with the top 3 teams in LMP1 Hybrid all based in Germany.
I support Porsche.
Cross my fingers for all 6 Porsche drivers. Let us make the same as last year, win Porsche here at the Nürburgring.
Race day morning's autograph session, always a big hit.
Oh, we just talked about it. I said there are more fans on the Nürburgring here than on Pukekohe in New Zealand. So we're just joking about it.
I'm really excited. I can't wait to go out and I have the pleasure to start the race. And weather's good today, so I can't wait.
Triumph, the tragedy, and the heartache of Le Mans is behind all the teams. The second half of the FIA World Endurance Championship season for 2016 starts right now. Just the second time at the Nürburgring, an extraordinary crowd on hand to witness the action.
It's a fantastic championship, there's no doubt. I mean, unfortunately, when we were around, This did not exist. Now it's very professional, very competitive, and very well organized. So it's really a very interesting thing.
Great atmosphere on the grid. Won't all be so friendly when the green flag drops. Ben Trelawney not here, injured his back in a mountain bike accident. Rearrange that into a well-known phrase or saying. The green flag will be waved by multiple skiing champion Maria Hoffel-Reich.
This is a fantastic atmosphere always on the Nürburgring. That historically, this is a great racetrack. And for me, the LMP1 has atmosphere, 6 hours to race with 3 competitive teams. So we have to accept a nice race.
The great and the good of motorsport, including Sir Lindsay Owen-Jones and Pierre Fillon, all on the grid sampling the fantastic atmosphere. An expectancy running around the crowd gathered towards the first set of corners at the Nürburgring. The arena section, always one of the action areas. And the German crowd know that. straight eight qualifying in GT and with the Porsche number 88 on pole position. In GTE Pro, the Dane train, the 95 Aston Martin, just ahead of the Ford and their teammates in the 97.
The quali was intense yesterday. It was typical Nürburgring weather, so we enjoyed it really a lot. So the guys back in the stage did a really good job with the right strategy and everything. So that's why we're here.
In LMP2, second in the championship, first on the grid for the Orica of G-Drive, ahead of both Alpine Nissans. The front three rows of the grid are all LMP1s, Toyota in positions 5 and 6, having to put the disappointment of Le Mans behind them and trying to work out what the keys to the race will be.
This is quite difficult with traffic because the track is quite narrow, and if you get caught behind in certain sectors, you can lose a lot. So, and tyre degradation, yeah, is going to be high, so going to be interesting to see how that plays out.
It's an old Porsche, second row of the grid, a new look to the front end of the 919 hybrid, and racing on home ground could give them an advantage.
I want to repeat that again, the victory from last year, which was a beginning of a fantastic winning streak. We have to say, I mean, I'm very happy for the WC and for the Nürburgring that so many fans came out. I mean, look, I mean, it is a fabulous crowd, which WC deserves.
The front row is all Audi. A new look to their car too, as they debut the high downforce kit we'll see in Mexico and for the rest of the season.
Just after the little issue we had in Le Mans, I think it's really, for everyone in the team, a really big motivation to be being back. And I think it could not be better with this all the crowd, to a lot of crowds here. It's amazing being back on Nürburgring and having pole position. I think it's a great opportunity for us to start on this place.
In the final moments on the grid before the race starts, just look at that grandstand packed out. They're anticipating who's going to win this race. We still don't know. Audi are locking out the front row for the first time. Porsche, we know, are strong, and Toyota have got the pace. So it's still anybody's game.
Triple Olympic champion Maria Hoffel-Riesch waves the green flag to get the first of two formation laps underway. It's Audi locking out the front row, then Porsche and Toyota following along behind in rows two and three. The LMP2s headed by the 26 G-Drive racing car on row five. The GTs, well, that's Aston Martin who sets the pace in GTE Pro. And in GTE Am, it's Porsche, and the number 88 car will be started by Patrick Long. The 6 hours of the Nürburgring is underway, and the two Audis stream off down towards the first corner. Toyota's in fifth and sixth. Look to the inside, it's very tight here. The Audis both go wide. Timo Bernhard in the first of the black and white Porsches trying to get in between them, and does, up into second position. The rest of the field comes down, and one, two, three, four abreast there for a moment in LMP2. But all the action is up at the sharp end of the field. The CLM has got ahead of the Rebellions for the top spot in privateers. That's the dark grey car in seventh position, just coming over the top of the hill now behind the leaders. What a start from Timo Bernhard. All kinds of action. Oh, the ESM and one of the Alpines very close together as they come down the hill towards the Dunlop hairpin for the first time. Gotta remind these guys, there's still nearly 6 hours to go. Cracking action early on here at the Nürburgring, exactly what we had expected. The number 30 and 31 cars, remember, on Michelin tyres for the first time. Here come the GTEs. 66 Ford right in the mix there. This is magnificent stuff. Qualifying was close, the race is even closer. Look ahead of the Ford there from Ollie Jarvis. That is Timo Bernhard, that's second position, going through the GT battle down the hill now. Second, third, and fourth there. Neil Jani coming through as well in the second of the Porsches. Ollie Jarvis gaining into the tighter of the two versions of the Vidal chicane. Didn't use this last year. Adds about 3.5 seconds to the lap time. Unique view looking backwards from the Ford. No other GTE car can do that. What a design that car is. And that's third place in the 66 with Stefan Mucha, Jimmy Bruni, multiple champion in the Ferrari number 51 for EF Corsa. Hoving interview behind, out of the final corner now. Gorgeous. Now, here are the leading cars coming through. Can Timo get down the inside? Has a little look. Now goes to the outside. Very late braking here. Oh, and the Audi's gone a little bit wide. It'll be side by side going into turn two. Ooh, close. And all this through traffic as well. What concentration. This is for the lead of the race. Audi Sport, Team Joost and Porsche, old rivals. And still the battle rages on through traffic. The distinctive prototype headlights. And this time, surely Timo will get a run round the outside. No, he's got traffic. And again, the Audi exactly where it needs to be to hold off the advances. Couldn't be any closer than that. Surely not round the outside of the final corner. Look at that traffic. All four classes together there coming across the starting line. Marcel Fesler goes to driver's right to try and hold off the advances, and hails Neil Jani as well. Look behind, Jani's locked up and he hits the Ford of Tignall. Neil Jani, slight mistake there. Oh, he nearly nailed Richie Stanaway in the Aston as well. That was so close. LMP2. And a lovely move down the inside by the RGR Sport Car, the 43, sponsored by our next race in Mexico. And that's a change of position there. SMP going back one spot. The GT action is absolutely extraordinary. And with prototypes coming through, everyone has got to have their head on a swivel here. That's the third place Audi that's trying to come through the fourth place battle in GTE Pro. Now with the prototype out the way, can these guys have a bit of a scrap on their own? Lovely outbraking manoeuvre down the inside. And it looks as though the second Ferrari, the EF Corsa number 71 car, is having a look around the outside as well. That's Ferrari on Ferrari action. Come on, boys, you're supposed to be teammates. First of the pit stops, 50 minutes into the race. From the lead then, Lotterer in, Fesler has got out. Just a pair of them doing this race this weekend, Ben Trelawney not here. Well, that's a lovely turnaround by the number 17. Gets them out in front of their teammates. Now, here's the pit stops for Porsche. Mark Lieb, with that distinctive blue helmet design that he's had for all of his career, gets in. The Audis have gone through as Lieb rejoins. Fourth position. And the Audis have swapped round, and this is how it happened. Marcel Fesler out of the car. He's in the pit lane with Louise Beckett.
Yeah, it was quite difficult in the traffic because it was easy to lose a lot. But also it was sometimes I was lucky to gain a lot between the number one Porsche and myself. But yeah, that's endurance racing, you know. You have to deal with the traffic too. It was, I think, sometimes quite hot, especially when a Porsche tried to overtake me at the end of the straight. And together with the traffic, yeah, it was a hot moment, I think, for him.
So Brendan Hartley now aboard the leading Porsche, the defending world champions, number one on the side of the car. Coming to the end of the first hour of hectic motor racing here in Germany. GTE Pro, Stanaway now versus Tinknell. That's Aston Martin versus Ford. And look in the background, Ferrari in third position, heads to the pits. Oh, this is going to be a battle for the pit crews now as they come in together. Harry peels off first into the 67 pit. Aston Martin further down the pit lane. Driver change going on there. Andy Priaulx in the car. Oh, there's a fuel spill! Fuel spill for the 67! And there's a fire in the pit lane. Need to get that dealt with quickly. Here come the fire marshals. Well done, lads. There looks to be fire inside the car, though, and Andy Priaulx bailing out. Don't blame him. Priaulx helped out by his team. Magnificent work by all concerned there.
All good, no problems. A little scare, but we're okay.
What happened in there?
Some fuel. It looked like some fuel spilled out onto the exhaust, and they had a little fire on the exhaust, so that's the way it goes.
Issues, but I find the issues as well. So traction I can handle.
Copy, Mark. We check what we can do.
Brendan has the ball. Starting to lose the rear on entry.
It's not going well for the Porsches. Vibration issues for Lieb. And Brendan Hartley in the one. Losing grip on the back end of the car. And he's being closed down by Ollie Jarvis. Jarvis dragging back towards him. Now, this was a moment or two ago as he goes past the RGR Morand car. He gets pushed to the outside. This is Hartley on board with him in the Porsche. Well, he's got through there, but it was all a bit unnecessary. And the lead's changed. Well, as we were watching what happened a moment ago, that is on board from Hartley, and Jarvis has gone through. So caught and passed. Clearly those rear tyre issues causing real problems, and that was very easy indeed from Ollie Jarvis. Now second position is in doubt for Brendan Hartley. Here they come down to the first corner. Two lights on the number one, three on the number seven. Oh, beautiful manoeuvre using the Gulf UK Porsche as a little bit of a shield there. And Brendan Hartley, who was leading a couple of laps ago, is now down to third.
Okay, mate, just a reminder, they stopped about four laps earlier than us. They're a bit lighter than us on fuel. Doing a good job, mate. Just keep your head down, keep pushing.
Kyle Wilson-Clark talking to Brendan Hartley there, just calming his driver down. Pit stop time again. And here comes the number two. The Audi's hit the pit lane, so that's another change of position. The Yost Audi mechanics go to work. So that number two Porsche just goes up into second position. Mark Lieb then in between the two Audis for now, but pit stops required. They're having a look at the front of that Audi. Look to the right-hand side. There goes the Toyota number five.
brand new set of Michelins. Going onto the left-hand side of the Audi, and the second Toyota has gone through. All the way down to fifth position during those pit stops for the Audi, but everyone else has got to stop, so no panic. That's the lead changing now as the number two Porsche going longer on fuel.
5 to go, Mark. 5 to go. Doing a great job. We can win this one. Keep up the pace.
Well, they've got the pace and they've got the fuel efficiency. Going easier lap, longer than the Audis. Look at Degrassi getting in there. So Mark Lee ahead of Buemi in second by half a minute. Porsche from Toyota. Great stint by Ollie Jarvis. Let's head down to the Audi garage where Luis can talk to him.
I mean, really enjoyed the stint. It's great to see us competitive after Le Mans and after last year here. So looks like a fantastic battle all the way for 6 hours. So just looking forward to sitting down and watching my teammates go out there and hopefully do a fantastic job.
The GTE battle just continues to entertain. This is third position, the 66 Ford GT, and on board here with Sam Bird in the 71, looking at the back of that very futuristic GT car. Watching the KCMG AM Porsche with the Corvette right in behind it, but not for very much longer. All sorts of traffic coming through as well. Classic overtaking manoeuvre, under brakes into the chicane. And that is the lead in GTM changing to the big American V8. Francois Perraudeau off in the gravel trap. That's by the chicane. Now what's happened here? Oh, misses his braking point. Very close to the back of the KCMG Porsche.
I've only got myself to blame. Stupid mistake. It's a shame because the stint was okay. I think we were P3, but we were all within, you know, one small group. And then I blocked the front tires and last chicane. Went into the gravel, so that cost me a couple of laps. And now we're trying to claw our way back, which is difficult. So it just goes to show, I mean, it's 6 hours, but you make one mistake and, you know, it could be over.
That is the 88 car in the pit lane. David Enemeyer Hansen brought that in, and there's been a fire. Earlier on, it wouldn't fire up, and now it's had a fire itself. Well, after a quick wash and brush up, the 88 car is back out on the circuit. Alex Brundle leads LMP2 for G-Drive. This is the battle for sixth position. Bruno Senna, those are his hands. That's Maurizio Medellani into turn one in the 27, the SMP racing car, and he can't hold the Brazilian back. Sixth and seventh position, swap over. Look at the traffic ahead of André Lotteret. He's got to find a way through that somehow. My goodness. Look at the eyes. Look how calm he is behind the steering wheel. Look how close he is to the leading LMP2 car. That's Alex Brundle that's going a lap down now. Battling GT cars. To 77 in front of him. And he's got through. Wow, that was a masterclass. Here's a bit of a GTE mix-up. The Aston Martin behind the Porsche there is one of the pro cars, the 97 machine. The blue and white Porsche is leading. Second is the Corvette. Oh, no, not anymore, because Matthias Lauda has just come through and pushed the Corvette down into third place. And here's Lauda going for the lead on Christian Reed. Reed has to take the shortcut over the chicane. Matthias Lauda just getting better and better as a sports car driver in that number 98 car he shares with Pedro Lamy and Paul Dallolana. Got to watch the two prototypes to his right. That's the Alpine going for a pass on the SMP, and Lauda tries to follow them through, and well, he's there. It's very close. He does follow them through. Good driving by Reed and Lauda there. That's a new leader in the AM category. Look in the background, the two Audis have closed right up. On board with André Lotterer through the S's. over the top of the brow, left-hander coming up. And there's been a change of position there with Lotterer now sitting in third place. Where did that happen? Oh, yes, just a little lift off there.
Lucas, next bit of traffic, Andre is going to let you by.
And clearly team orders there from Audi. Well, this is drama for G-Drive. They were leading the race and second in the LMP2 Championship. Alex Brundle's brought the car in. Clearly a gearbox issue. New leader in LMP2 is the leader of the LMP2 Championship. This is bad news for G-Drive, great news for Signatec Alpine. At the moment, they're stretching their championship lead. Manor in second place, Straka Racing a fine third. Mark Webber, the leader, is in the pits. The Audis are going by. There he is, in the pit lane. Another fine stint behind the wheel of the 919 from the lanky Australian. He gets out, Timo Bernard gets back in. So all of their three drivers have had a go now. Andy Davison into the pit lane. A little bit of damage on the left front means a new nose for that car. That's the least of their worries, really. Just haven't been able to switch on their tyres and get the pace they wanted. Anthony Davison shaking his head there. This is not the comeback they wanted after Le Mans, and of course that bitter disappointment. Audi coming through the GTE Pro battle. Wow, that EcoBoost 3.5 litre in the Ford sounds great. Proper GT cars on a proper circuit. Gustavo Menezes then leading for Signatec Alpine from the 45 Manor in second. Matt Rau with Bruno Senna in third in the RGR racing car. Fifth place in LMP2 is Tor Graves in the Manor number 44. And just a moment ago, he had a huge wiggle at it off. Did well to keep hold of that. No runoff at all there. A weekend crowd of 58,000 providing a brilliant atmosphere and a backdrop to all the activities as well as the track action here at the Nürburgring.
It's the first race after Le Mans, so it's really interesting to see how they perform under the high downforce track here.
On espère voir Toyota nous refaire revivre l'histoire qu'ils ont fait vivre au Mans, en espérant qu'ils gagnent aussi.
Siamo partiti questa notte da Forlimpopoli, siamo arrivati questa mattina perché dovevamo sostenere Davide e avevamo voglia di venire a vedere il WEC.
The Le Mans spirit is here. It's great. It's great.
It's totally impressive that the guys can do such a long race. I mean, for me as a ski racer, I just had always between 1 and 2 minutes of a race, which was, of course, also very intense. But for hours being in that car and have that high concentration, that's pretty impressive.
Well, there's a full course yellow coming, yellow flag at the moment for that car. Eduardo Freitas already having advised the teams, and that's why the number four car at turn four. A little bit of smoke coming from the side of the car where they had problems at Le Mans. New side pods and bodywork for the CLM. In comes the Porsche, taking advantage of the full course yellow. Timo Bernard is getting out. Should be Brendan Hartley getting in on rotation. Super quick pit stop by the two car. Will get it out ahead of its teammates. They're still changing tyres. Audi a little bit further back up the pit lane. Brand new Michelins going onto the left side there. Gerard Navarre and Sir Lindsay Owen-Jones talking with Wolfgang Ulrich. Pierre Fillon just there as well.
3, 2, 1. Track is back to green. Track is back to green. We're back to racing speed.
Well, the 78 KCMG Porsche driver there, a little bit of sleep as the pro car went past. Eduardo talking to us and to the teams, remember, they hear that communication as well. Gulf UK trying to go the long way around there in the 66. Battle for the GTE Pro lead, Aston and Ferrari. Nicky Teeb in the Aston and Jimmy Bruni in the Ferrari goes down the inside at turn number 3. He's on the wrong side here for 4. Oh, cuts across in front. Lovely manoeuvre. I wonder if Nicky Teeb was just distracted by the ESM there. That's a new leader in GTE Pro. Let's have another look at this. Very, very incisive move from the Ferrari driver. Oh, there was a little touch. Second place in LMP2, the Audi factory driver, Philippe Albuquerque. You can tell that from his gloves. His teammate Bruno Senna's in the pit lane with Luis.
It's fantastic to be on the pace here. I think we struggled for pace a little bit in the last two races. And here we're fighting for a good podium so far, and I think we can push the leaders a little bit. So, yeah, I hope we can keep on the fight, and that should be fun.
Now, this is not a regular stop for the number 6 Toyota. Weren't expecting them in for a while. And the dollies are underneath. It's going into the garage.
There was a problem around the engine, yes. Parts came loose. We had to check it quickly. They have replaced the part. And what the root cause is, the real reason, we don't know yet. We should be able to continue now.
Oh, well, that's a change of position. The Ford ahead of the Aston Martin. Darren Turner has lost a position to the 66 Ford GT. I'm not sure how that happened, actually. Well, here is the answer. Couple of prototypes down the inside, and Darren Turner is blocked out at the exit of turn 1. Oh, Sam Bird has gone rally crossing. That's why we have the yellow flag down at turn 5 and 6. ...42 Straka with Nick Leventis has Vitaly Petrov right on his tail. Great to see Straka being so competitive this weekend. ...44 Manikar now up to Nick Leventis and goes side by side out of the final corner. Well, I tell you what, you couldn't pick them apart across the line there, which is quite early on the start-finish straight. But that is a change for fourth position. Nick Leventis giving up that place. He wants to pick the battles he can win. Porsche number 2 leading the motor race and due into the pits fairly shortly. Mark Lieb doing a great job out there. Oh, what am I seeing? He's gone into the side of the number 88 of Kalanil Kibasi coming down the hill. Mistake there from Mark Lieb. Let's have a look at it again. Le gets locked up on the inside. That was heavy contact there. Oh, Mark will not be happy
full
with himself there.
Yellow. We are under full course yellow.
Alcabesi's car will be taken to a place of safety. A little bit of damage on the left front there. Oh, well, the Porsche GT car running again, spraying gravel everywhere. The Porsche prototype into the pit lane. And the new front end inevitable after that collision. And in fact, that's taken so much time, they're going to have to follow their teammate out here. That's a change of position in the pit lane.
track is back to green. Thank you very much for your understanding.
And a drive-through penalty assessed on the number two car. Mark Leib's not in it, but it was his actions that have caused this penalty. That is going to cost them a position on the racetrack to Audi. And through goes the number seven car. Now look to the right-hand side. Oh, this is going to be closer than I thought, actually, down into turn one. But the Audi has gone around. So the number two Porsche now down into third place. So it's Porsche, Audi, Porsche, Audi.
Well, these are the rules. We are in the faster cars. I caused the accident. I hit the 88 car. So we accept the decision. It's tough, you know. In these cars, you have to make decisions very quickly. And I thought he's moving to the left, open the door, because normally we go on the outside. I tried to pass him on the inside. It was the wrong decision. That's racing.
So here is Neil Jarny. And he's chasing down Loic Duval coming into the first corner. He's got a good run. Duval goes to the inside. Duval can defend that. He'll just push the Porsche out a little bit wide. Oh, he has. He's done it beautifully. Absolutely beautifully.
Whoa, he pushed me out. The fuck?
We can see that Heidi took you off the track.
Well, the move of the race is a defensive one, not an offensive one, as the number 8 Audi of Loic Duval just eases Neil Jarny onto the dirt, and that has not only held his position, but allowed Andrea Lotterer to close up and join the battle. Well, Andrea Lotterer has dragged up behind the battle for second and third now. Loic Duval, Neil Jarny, and now Lotterer. And Lotterer is desperately trying to get third position, not just for himself, but for the championship. Remember that number two, leading the Drivers' Championship at the moment, goes to the outside. That looked very easy indeed. Can he hang on to it through the S's? There's a little dab, a little touch. And I think Neil Jarny will hold on to that. Well, very aggressive from both drivers, but that's fair. This is important for the championship. Look again. Is there a little touch? The Porsche gets on the curb on the inside, and that's what unsettles it. Was there a little glance to the left there from Andrea Lotterer at his opponent? Inside the last hour, and still third and fourth battling again. This is a very late dive down the inside. Lotterer surely can't pull that off, but he has. Remarkable. Oh, there was a touch on the Porsche, but not from the Audi. It was from the SMP behind. There's damage to the left rear as they go side by side through the final corner. Magnificent racing. Brilliant stuff. The crowd are loving this at the Nürburgring. And the Porsche holds on to third position, but for how much longer? Now, last time he got forced out. Can he do the same move? He can. He's Duval'd Lotterer. Brilliant stuff. Learned from his own experience from the Audi driver earlier on, and this time Lotterer is the one who's pushed a little wide. But he's going down the inside of turn three, and there's another clash of cars. The most impressive and technologically advanced racing cars in the world, and they're banging doors with 55 minutes to go. Lotterer through to third position, Neil Jarny down to fourth, and with a damaged car.
Neil, no more contact. We have damage on the rear, damage on the rear.
Now, just to underline here, this was damage caused by the SMP, not by the banging with the Audi, and that's quite a big bit of carbon fibre. Here's the pass. Well, one of the attempts. Again, up on the curb. Again, trading paint. Romain Dumas not happy in the Porsche garage. Jimmy Bruni leading GT Pro in the AF course of Ferrari. He's won in WEC plenty of times. His teammate, James Collado, still to do that.
It's been good up until now. It's not over yet, obviously. We know what happened in the first few races. We got a bit unlucky, so fingers crossed. But no, in terms of pace, we've been pretty good. I think I've got to say that I think now all the cars are quite fair. I think the ACO have done a good job with the BOP, and I hope it doesn't change because we've seen some great racing so far.
Black and orange flag means there's a mechanical problem with the number two car that race control wants them to come back in and fix. And that is, of course, because of the back end of the car. Carbon fibre likely to fall off, pieces trailing. That could be a danger to other competitors. And here they come now. See the damage on the back end there and a little bit of rubbing mark. Now the deck comes off in one piece, but they'll hold on to that. It's the bit behind that, behind the back wheels. It's gone on lovely. Well, that's the good news. Everything has fit perfectly and they're back in the race. Less than half an hour to go. Second and third together for Audi. And the Audis are the right way around for championship positions. The number 8 car further up the world championship standings than the 7. So there'll be no more attacking from André Lotterer. The crowd have enjoyed this race and stayed right to the end. A little bit of evening sunshine greeting them and the number 1 Porsche coming round for its second victory in 2 years here. And remember, last year, the win here in Germany started that magnificent run that took them to the World Championship. They've had a horrible start to the 2016 season. Will history repeat itself here? Yes, it will. Will it repeat for the rest of the year? We'll have to wait and see. But for now, the champagne will taste sweet for the number 1 Porsche team.
Three, one. Nice one, mate. Nürburgring 6 hours. Boys, well done. Absolutely blinding. You boys have brought us in the pink on track. Well done, guys. Well done, everyone.
I can't really disturb this right now, can I? Just let them have a moment. Timo, that was a superb, superb race.
Well, absolutely. I mean, we had a tough first part of the season, and we really wanted a victory on home ground for Porsche. And I mean, Porsche victory was important, but we really wanted that so bad. And very happy, very proud of that crew to come back after the first part of the season. So really, really good.
Great to see the gates open onto the track for the huge crowd to head down towards the podium and join the celebrations. The LMP2 winner, the 36 Alpine.
The car was really fast in the race. We could push all the race through, and my teammate and the team did a fantastic job. So we are really happy for this win and also for the lead of the championship. It's a great result today.
A rousing rendition of the Marseillaise from the Alpine team. Top of the podium for them. RGR Sport in second before their home race in Mexico. Top step of the podium for the first time in WEC for James Calado. A record-breaking 13 for Jimmy Bruni.
It was a nice fight from lap one until last lap. Finally, like he said, we have really bad luck. I think by now I should have more in the pocket of this win, but this is motor racing. We are very happy for Ferrari 1 and 2. We start from here. Our season starts today.
Off to Mexico with a win under their belts. Aston Martin and the 95 Dane train in third position behind the two Ferraris. And Ferrari lead the manufacturer's championship. In GTE, Matthias Lauda, Pedro Lamy and Paul Dallolana take the victory for Aston Martin.
Anytime you can come back and get a result like this, it makes it all worthwhile. But this is such a great event, and I got to say, the fans here, the whole ambiance of the place, just a feeling of motorsports. So to win here as well is special. So really excited for that.
The celebration on the podium for Aston Martin and for Ferrari, but for Porsche in second place, it was short-lived as the scrutineers found their car to be outside of eligibility and they were taken out of the results. It's two in a row in the Eiffel and a perfect result this weekend for Porsche. Confirmation they'll have the chance to make it a hat-trick next year on the 14th to the 16th of July here at the Nürburgring. They lead the World Endurance Manufacturers Championship. And the party can begin. So Porsche have the victory to take on our travels as the whole of the FIA World Endurance Championship begin to think about destinations far from Europe. We'll be right back. so the paddock are packing their bags, but it's no holiday as the competition heats up on our flyaway races that will decide the 2016 FIA World Endurance Championships, next in Mexico City.
A new story begins. A stadium for theater. Endurance back on the old path.
World Endurance Championship. International event.
New. Better.
9 and 18.7.
Faster.
Go to the Labra car. He's blocking me. Labra F car.
Crowd.
6 hours of Mexico on 2nd and 3rd September. The spirit of Le Mans is coming to Mexico.